You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Theater 100. My name is Naomi Buckley, and we today are in our session 13. And today we're going to be talking about lights and sound. That's going to take place at the end of the broadcast today. And of course, we're going to start with a little bit of theater history. I do want to remind you that we are live and online. You can give us a call anytime at 1-800-339-1193. And you can also type in your comments, questions, or your answer to the question of the day at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. Before we get going today with our question of the day or anything, of course, there's a little housekeeping that I want to do. So I want to remind you guys that your stage play analysis is due this Sunday. I know that some of you have already turned it in. A few of you had some issues and you emailed me and I emailed you back. So please make sure you check your email today before before the final assignment is due on Sunday at midnight. Also, there's no test, as you know, there's just the stage review. And I went on today and I graded the last, not this week's discussion board, but last week's discussion board. The only thing now that's not graded in your blackboard is your film review, and obviously your stage review if you haven't done it yet. So I'm gonna get started on those and I should finish them up by the end of the weekend. And the reason why I'm telling you that is because, of course, we're coming to the end of the semester and it's really important for some of you to start really paying attention to your grade if you haven't already. There are a few of you that are having less than what I would like to see in terms of your points and your grade. So go ahead and take a look. The other reason why I want you to take a look is not just because we're coming to the end and it's really important that, you know, you make sure that you get everything in on time and before we're done with the class, but also because some of you may have noticed that I had done it all the way up into the last 3 or 4 weeks, but when I go through and I grade your discussion boards or I grade your tests or anything like that, if you for some reason haven't done the discussion board or you haven't done the test, when I go through and I grade it, I have the option of doing one of two things in Blackboard. I have the option of leaving the grade mark blank, or I have the option of giving you a zero. Now, like right before the midterm, I went through, and even though I had left a lot of those undone assignments just blank because I wasn't sure, maybe people were gonna see if they could turn in things late, what was happening. I knew there were a few students that were out of town and had medical issues and they needed to do things later on. So I left those blank, but then at the midterm, I filled them all in with zeros. I just did that again. I went through and any discussion boards that you haven't done were filled in with a zero, so they are no longer blank. Any quizzes that you did not do have been filled in with a zero. They are no longer blank. What that means is that now that grade, if you didn't do it, is gonna be factored into your final grade and it's gonna lower your grade. So before, when I had it blank, it meant it wasn't factoring your grade with that included into it. So your grade maybe looked really good, right? But if you've missed 3 discussion boards, and some of you have, and I went through and I put those zeros in there, now what you're gonna see is that you're missing 60 points. And of course, that's going to lower your grade. So please go in and take a look and be aware of where your grade is now, okay? If you had an extenuating circumstance, you had something medical, you had a family emergency that happened and you weren't able to do discussion board because of that, then contact me. And I'm usually more than willing to work something out with you so that you can get those points. Also, if you feel that you are in danger of failing or getting a D in the class, now is probably a good time to contact me. A couple of you already have, to see if maybe there's something you can do, some extra credit or extra work that you might be able to do to try to bring your grade up a little bit, okay? For those of you that may be in that position, there's not too many of you, but for those of you that may be, I just want to say the deal is that at this point, obviously, we're almost all the way through. If you need extra credit to pass a class, I'm happy to do that. But I'm never going to give you extra credit so that, you know, enough extra credit to make up for all of your assignments and get you like an A plus in class. That's not going to happen. It's not fair to everybody else who's done their work all along and has been responsible and turned their things in on time and been conscientious and responsible students. But I also don't want to see you fail. So, or have to take the class again. I mean, so if you need some help and you would like to pass the class, then now is the time you need to start emailing me, because we're about 3 or 4 weeks before the end of the semester, and there's not much more time for you to even be able to accomplish something that would lift your grade. So please, guys, the whole point of all this is go online, check your grade sometime before the end of this week, and make an assessment of what needs to take place in order for you to pass a class before we end this semester. All right, just a few more things. In the syllabus, at the beginning of the semester, and if you've taken a look since, we originally said that we were going to have 9 quizzes. As I was going through the day and I was checking our grade book and everything, it actually turns out we're only going to have 7 quizzes. We've only done, I think, 5 of them so far, and there's only 2 more left. You're going to have, you don't have one this week, but you do have one next week on Angels in America, and then you'll have one the following week on directing, and then you have one the following week, but it's not a quiz, it's your final exam. So there's only 2 more left, and there's really only time to get 2 more in. I don't want to like have you guys do 2 quizzes in a week. So it's really not going to affect anything, guys, because the Blackboard just kind of, it calculates your grade based on what we put in. So, you know, your grade is your grade, it's not going to change. Just if you're looking to maybe get a sense of what you might get at the end of the semester, then just be aware that there's only 2 more quizzes left and the final exam. Okay? And the 2 quizzes that are left is one's going to be on Angels in America and one is going to be on directing. Okay? So I think that's all the things that I want to address in this little housekeeping portion of the broadcast today. Jacqueline just asked a quick question. What email can we use to contact you? Please use my campus email address in buckley@csudh.edu. Okay? For whatever, any time you need to get a hold of me, that's where you can get me. Okay? All right, guys. So that brings us to our question of the day. And that is, what are some objectives for a lighting designer in a play? What are some of the things that they're thinking about that they need to accomplish as a lighting designer for a play? So I look forward to hearing your answers to that. And of course, you know that if you respond, you call in today, you get 3 points of extra credit. Some of you may need that, so you might be thinking about doing that for the rest of the broadcast that we have left. All right. Today, of course, we're going to return to doing our little bit of theater history, and we are going to start by looking at one of the last areas of theater history, which really brings us up to date in terms of where we are right now in the world of theater, and it brings us to contemporary theater. So in the 60s, we had this kind of whole swinging shift. We, you know, last time when we talked about theater history, we were there in realism, when we were talking about this wave of realism that, you know, came across all of Western Europe and into the Americas and really influenced all the styles of theater that we have now. And then also the backlash against that we had Expressionism, that we had epic theater from Brecht, that we had Romanticism and Surrealism and Absurdism, right? We had all these different kinds of genres that kind of were butting up against realism. But as I said last time, very few of these really survived the test of time, and we find that the dominating style that's come into fashion is really realism. So this style really dominates everything that we see from the turn of the century in the 1900s all the way through to the 50s. And when we get into the 60s, we start seeing the 50s and the 60s. We start seeing that there's a really strong movement against realism, that there's this kind of feeling that there should be other ways, and That it's restrictive. We even talked about that one when it was coming about, right? That it's kind of a restrictive form and it doesn't allow for as much artistic and creative voices. And so there's really like this big backlash. Of course, that was happening not just in the world of theater, it was happening in all the performing arts and in a lot of the visual arts and other arts as well, right? So there's this big backlash and it leads to a variety of different forms of expression and some really, really highly abstracted forms of art, not only, again, in the world of theater, but in dance and in music and in the visual arts. And people started also feeling that they should be able to use theater to make political statements, that there should be a polemic use for theater, that it shouldn't just have to be talking about, you know, real events that happen in people's lives, that we should be able to be metaphorical and symbolic, and we should be able to use the theater to communicate political messages. And you remember that the 60s and even the 70s were highly politically charged, and there was a lot of things happening from the civil rights movement to the feminist movement to the war in Vietnam and that kind of generating a peace movement. So there was a lot of things that people wanted to talk about and they wanted to use the theater to do so. And again, the realm of realism is not always the best way to do that when you have something that is an abstract concept. Politics is really an abstract concept. So, you know, people started wanting to use the theater to do these things and that was changing the forms as well. Well, the Living Theater and many other theater groups started from this era. And they were a group that was formed out of the 60s. And they did a play called Six Public Acts. They were highly influenced by Andrei Antonin's writings. And Andrei Antonin was a guy that came out of the 40s and the 50s, a very strange, unique man who created, he had his own theater, he was French. And he had his own style of theater that he dubbed the theater of cruelty. And it was a very unique sort of theater that was based a lot around not only kind of returning theater back to its kind of ritual origins and this kind of meditative quality, but also it was very much a theater that was intended kind of like Brecht's theater. Brecht was actually also influenced by Artaud, to kind of shake people out of their comfort zone, right? And when he said that this is a theater of cruelty, he wasn't intending that when you go to the theater as an audience member, you would feel like you're being treated badly. But it was intended to sort of be a theater that was not about comfort, right? That was not about soothing people. It was about making people alert and aware of all of their senses, pleasant senses and unpleasant senses. And so he had a lot of different plays. If you get an opportunity, one of the things that you can find of his that I think is really a nice little, a small packet that gives you a good taste of what his work is like, it's called Jet of Blood. And it is a very surreal piece. God appears, cockroaches rain out of the sky, a jet of blood apparently is supposed to spray onto the audience, you know. There's a lot of, it's very highly sexualized, there's a lot of nudity, there's references to drugs, there's, you know, political statements made in it from the time. And again, this is what the Living Theater really drew from. It was this kind of a world of very surreal, but very in your face, very provocative, and intended to shake the audience up and to get them thinking and feeling. And they also, you know, had a lot of nudity and not only talk about drugs, but drug consumption in their plays and political statements about Vietnam. So you can see the connections there between the two groups. Another author, playwright, who was influenced by Artaud was Peter Weiss. And Peter Weiss is a playwright. He was sort of a journalistic playwright. He was actually one of the first playwrights to actually do what we now call sort of almost verbatim theater or journalistic theater, right? And this was kind of another genre that was developing out of the 60s. And this was the idea that we could, an offshoot of realism, but we're going to actually watch a clip from Murat Saad, as you'll see, definitely not realism in quite a few ways, right? And journalistic or verbatim theater kind of has, it goes the whole gamut. There are some pieces that are done that are literally like, I'm thinking of Exonerated by the Actors Gang. I'm also thinking of the play about Sam Shepard, Laramie Project, right? Where this is literally where playwrights and actors have gone and interviewed people and recorded them and just transcribed everything that these people said and then took those words exactly verbatim and cut them together into a narrative piece that forms a play. So there are pieces that are very, very true to the original form. They don't change the words of the people that were saying them. They're written exactly as these people said them. But there is still a level of creativity and fictionalization in that the play is cut and spliced in a way that obviously isn't just listening to hours and hours of of, you know, interview. And it's intended to have a sort of narrative form. They're very much like documentaries in some ways, right? So if any of you watch, you know, documentaries on Netflix or Hulu or any of those, and especially like the more narrative documentary forms, like Making a Murderer, those forms kind of follow closely and actually are in many ways refer back to this theatrical form, because this theatrical form was around before that. So it really ranges the gamut. But Peter Weiss started out as a journalistic playwright and then kind of like veered off into lots of different things. And Murat Saad is actually a play that is written about, it's a play within a play. So it references the Saad part, references the Makita Saad, who was a very infamous character that was alive during the 17th century in France, and was eventually arrested and put into an insane asylum, an asylum for the criminally insane. And the reason why he was put into an asylum for the criminally insane was because he was accused of sexually abusing several of his servants, especially his young male servants, and not just sexually abusing them, but physically abusing them too. So it's interesting to me because throughout history, if you read things about the Marquis de Sade, he's kind of championed as this great like free speech hero, because people often say, oh, he was really arrested because he wrote all these erotic novels that were, you know, just very graphic. And yes, the public at the time did not approve of that. But ultimately, the reason why he was put into jail, quite rightly, was because he was actually a sexual predator. So he's really not the kind of, you know, person you want to make into a hero. At the same time, he's been a very intriguing figure throughout all of history, and he has a very interesting story, and people are obviously captivated by the elements of that story. And Peter Weiss was captivated as well. And so it is said that once the Marquis de Sade was put into this institution for the criminally insane, that he did often continued to write, and that he often actually did write plays for the inmates there to perform with him. And he would be in them, and he would direct them. And then sometimes the guy who was in charge, the manager of the asylum, would invite all these, you know, rich aristocratic friends to come and watch these plays that he would write for the inmates. And this whole play, Murat Saad, is actually based on that. And Murat is the name of the institution that he was held in. And so it's actually, you can't see it here, but the full title is Murat / Saad. So it's just a combination of those two ideas. And the reason why it is a play within a play is because it is literally, the idea of the play is that the Marquis de Sade has been imprisoned in this, you know, institution for the criminally insane. And he writes a play about another French author who's about to be put to death because of something that the author has written that the government doesn't approve of. So, you know, it's kind of this weird, like, you know, these themes of like speaking, you know, speaking out against powerful governments and institutions, speaking truth to power, and yet he puts it on for all of these aristocrats inside of this asylum that are apparently watching the Marquis de Sade with all these insane people putting on this show So it's like you're, as an audience member, watching people watching a play that is a play about something that happened in history. So it's very what we would call a meta narrative, right? That it's kind of like this mirrored room that you're in, where there are a lot of different ways to look at it, and you are kind of just one part of the reflection that kind of goes off into infinity. And in addition, that the play itself is somehow aware of its playness, of its, that it is a piece of art, that it is a structure that is being presented for a viewing audience. So there's all kinds of interesting things happening here, and it's a really, really, really great example of postmodernism in the 20th and 21st century. And we have a clip here, so hopefully all my babbling about it that maybe doesn't make a lot of sense will make sense when you watch it. But one of the things that I want to say before we watch it is that for any of you that maybe ever read this play or ever go and see it, one of the other things that is unique but is completely in line with the style of the play and the purpose of the play is that the play itself is actually written in verse. It's written in rhyming verse, right? So that would be the way that plays were written before the 19th century, right? So 18th century, 17th century, all that, all going all the way back, we had plays written in verse. We had elevated language. We know all about that. Shakespeare's plays were written in verse. Molière's plays were written in verse, right? So we get all these playwrights that have written in verse for hundreds and thousands of years, and it was the style of writing. It was expected. So when we see this play that's supposed to be existing in the 17th century, that's written by the Marquis de Sade that lived in the 17th century, of course the play that he would present would be a play that was written in verse and in rhyming verse and elevated, right? So even though we are a modern audience, this was written by a modern author, right? It was written in 1961. So even though we are this modern audience looking at it, we are kind of looking back through this keyhole, through time, to peer in on this experience that apparently took place, right? Peter Weiss, you mean this play that Peter Weiss has written is not a play that the Marat Sade actually, I mean, not the Marquis de Sade actually wrote. This is an extrapolation. But there are many elements of it that are true. So I'm because I think it'll make a lot more sense to you, hopefully, once you see it in front of you. So let's watch this clip from the Marat Sade.
Won't be marred by all these instruments for mental and physical hygiene. Quite on the contrary, they set the scene. In Monsieur de Sade's play, he has tried to show how Jean-Paul Marat died and how he waited in his bath before Charlotte Corday came knocking at his door.
Distinguished visitors, let us go back to the France of 15 years ago. Recall the greatest shock of modern times. Those golden victories, those scarlet crimes. The force which shattered every institution. That global earthquake, the French Revolution. None of us knew a revolutionary more passionate than Marat. But was he the people's friend or freedom's enemy? A writer of books with hope on every page, or the most vicious butcher of his age? Marat the good or bad? The choice is hard. Let us hear Marat debating with de Sade, two champions wrestling with each other's views. How do we judge the winner? You must choose. Here is Marat, back from the dead. He wears a bandage around his head. His flesh burns. It is yellow as cheese, because disfigured by a skin disease. And only water, cooling every limb, prevents his fever from consuming him. To act this weighty role, we chose a lucky paranoid, one of those who've made unprecedented strides since we introduced them to hydrotherapy. This one was with him to the very end. Simon Evra, his dogged lady friend. Here is Charlotte Corday, waiting for her entry. A country girl, her family landed gentry. Unfortunately, the girl who plays the role here has sleeping sickness, also melancholia. Our hope must be for this afflicted soul that she does not forget her role. Her friend is Monsieur Duperey. You'll note his upper-class toupee. This actor's good, though subject to attacks. One of our brightest sexual maniacs. Jailed for taking a radical view of anything you can name. The former priest, Jacques Roux, ally of Nana's revolution. But unfortunately, the censors cut most of his rabble-rousing theme. Our moral guardians found it too extreme. And now, our vocalists, Cocorico! Pop-pop! Coco! And on the streets no longer, Rossignol! Now meet this gentleman from high society, who under the lurid star of notoriety came to live with us just 5 years ago. It's to his genius that we owe this show, the former Marquis Monsieur de Sade, whose books were banned, his essays barred, while he's been prosecuted and reviled, thrown into jail and for some years exiled. The introduction's over. Now the play of Jean-Paul Marat can get underway. Tonight, the date is the 13th of July, 1808. And on this night, our cast intend showing how 15 years ago, night without end fell on this man, this invalid. And you are going to see him bleed. And see this woman, after careful thought, take up the dagger and cut him short. Homage to Marat!
So one of the things I want to point out is that there are a couple times when you're watching that clip of the film where the camera swings around and we get to see through the bars the actors, right, who are also the patients at the asylum. And we see the bars and it's like we're with the aristocrats, we're with the aristocratic audience watching this happen. Now, when Peter Vies actually first did this play in New York, that is exactly the way it was staged, with bars in front of the stage and the audience made to feel as if they were the aristocrats that were watching the scene. So again, it's this play within the play. The first character that you see coming in is actually the guy who's the manager of the asylum. And then you see the narrator character, and then you're introduced to all the actors, right? You go behind the bars. They do that obviously with the camera. But if you had been watching it in the theater, you certainly wouldn't have been able to do that. And oftentimes when this play is remounted, that is how it's done. You can go online and you can see some very modern productions of this where it's done with chain link fencing and often the audience is sat kind of in the round. In this instance, the audience isn't. But it's this idea and this feeling of immersion into the piece as well. So a wonderful example, really, really interesting play, and a good example of postmodernism in the 20th and 21st century. All right. So moving on, there were, of course, other theater groups and other styles that arrived as well in the 60s. The San Francisco Mime Troupe evolved out of the 60s. This is a group that's still around today. The Bread and Puppet Theater in Vermont evolved in 1961, was commissioned in 1961. And this is a group that uses puppets of varying sizes and live actors to tell stories based on myths, based on religious texts, well-known tales. And it's really, its whole purpose was to denounce the evils of materialism and deception in society. And there's all kinds of they're still around today too, that all kinds of interesting things that they did. They would do marches and they would bring, you kind of see that behind me, these giant, like enormous puppets operated by several people. There's things that they would do out in fields, and they would bring people out there. And then they also have their own theater space, and there are things that they would do there. The pieces tend to be very abstract. They tend to be very meditative. They tend to be highly visual in their nature and very subjective, meaning like when you watch it, it's more about what you understand is happening in the scene or in the play rather than there necessarily being a really clear plot or narrative text. In the 70s, we evolved new and changing styles. There were new approaches that mixed different styles together that began mixing realism with these other abstracted styles and even went back and took things from different time periods. And also, you know, began looking at the world of theater, not only theater, but literature, art, architecture, philosophy in a new way. I've said this word a couple times, but this is really when postmodernism comes into its own. We see the beginnings of it in all of these things that I've talked about, but this is when the idea and the philosophy really develops into something clear and identifiable. So maybe you've heard the term postmodernism before. We did talk about postmodern musicals, right? We talked about this idea of musicals that have been done, you know, since the 90s, the 80s and 90s, and how they've verged into this postmodern world. But let's really give it a definition, because it is a very complex idea. It applies not just to theater, but to a whole range of things. And I think that it's really useful for you to understand it in terms of how you might understand theater that you see today, films that you see today, really anything. It's a way of, it's a lens with which to look through the world at. So what is it really? Well, postmodernism is really, it's a reaction against the certainty, the assumed certainty of scientific or objective efforts to explain reality. And those efforts evolved out of modernism. And modernism is defined basically as the period, sometimes we use the 40s, part of the 40s, verging all the way through to the end of the 50s and part of the 60s. So that was when modernism existed, right? And modernism was sort of obsessed with materialism. And I don't mean materialism in the sense of like getting things, right, and consumerism, although there was a concern with that. But materialism in the sense that this was a time period in which we thought as humans, philosophically, in a lot of ways, artistically, in a lot of other ways, that the world was knowable. The universe was knowable. That we as humans were so, so smart. And I mean, you could see that. I mean, the advances that we made in that time period were, I mean, we put people on the moon. We invented computers. We did all these crazy things. It was happening radically fast, faster than it ever had before. We were discovering new things all the time, making new things all the time. There was this real feeling that humans could do anything and that the universe, eventually we would find a way to explain everything. Everything in the universe would be explainable. Everything would be explainable through some kind of scientific equation or, you know, some kind of understanding. And that there were knowable truths, right? That there were things that are universal, knowable truths, and that they are the same for everybody. And these were really some of the tenets that modernism was faced on. This sense of kind of human exceptionalism, that we are the exceptional, superior, intelligent beings, the only ones, and we're going to conquer everything as is our right. So postmodernism is really a reaction against that. It's kind of turning all those ideas around, and it's saying that no, actually, there is a possibility that we will never know anything, that the universe is unknowable, that science isn't the only way to explain everything. In fact, it's maybe not even the best way to explain everything, that there is no universal truths. There are only subjective truths. There are truths that I have and that you have, but they may coincide sometimes, but everybody has a different perspective. And all the perspectives are equal. There's not one that's better than another. It was also a look back at the forms and structures going all the way back into Greek civilization, that there are forms and structures that should be adhered to that make things right or good or better or complete somehow, right? We think back to the classical Greek rules of unity of time, space, and action, then forwarding into the neoclassical rules, rules about the way theater should be composed, plot lines and such, and what's good to put on the stage, or what's good to put on a canvas, or what is the right way to make a house? Because postmodernism really does stretch everything. And postmodernism was about questioning all those things and saying that there is not one right way. There are many ways, and some of them are right for you and other ways are right for me. And that when we look at literature or theater, that we can use the lens of our own perception, our own subjective viewpoint to interpret, that there is not one universal way to correctly interpret something and see something, and that your way of seeing it is just as good as my way of seeing it. This generated all kinds of, obviously, this is a, you know, it's a concept, but when you kind of take it to its end, it ventures off into, you know, very, very new ways of thinking about things. One of the things that that comes out of this is something we were kind of just talking about with something we call meta-theatrical, right, or meta-narratives. And it is this sense that because there is no right or wrong way to do anything, there are no rules anymore, right? There's no rules. We can do whatever we want. We can write however we want. We can tell stories however we want, as long as it tells the story that we want to tell, right? So we get this development called meta-narratives or meta-theatrical theater. And this is where we get pieces that are aware of themselves. Now, an example of this in literature is The French Lieutenant's Woman, where we're reading this book, and we're reading it seems like a normal book that's set in the 18th century. And then something like halfway through the book, the actual author's voice begins inserted into the narrative of the book. The person who's writing the novel, his voice becomes inserted into it. And then eventually the author like confesses that he doesn't know how to end the book, right? So this is an example of a meta-narrative. It's the idea that you're reading something and it's supposed to kind of take you out of your reality, but then somehow like reality comes crashing in, and not only, you know, are you aware of the reality, but the artwork itself is changed by this sort of reality, this other narrative coming in, this outside narrative coming in, right? So I'm sure that you can think of lots of other pieces and movies that have similar kind of ideas going on in them. Those are all part of the voice that came out of this postmodernist movement. So who are some of our postmodernist theatrical practitioners? Well, Robert Wilson was a huge person in the postmodernist movement in theater in the 70s and 80s. And he did a variety of pieces. One of them was called Einstein on the Beach. It's probably his most well-known postmodernist work. And it really was a mix between visual art and the theater. Because again, remember, this is all about rule breaking. There are no genres. There is no, like, there's not theater and art. There can be theater and art. Art can be theater and theater can be art, right? So they can just kind of like mix everything together, and we don't have to follow any rules anymore. And that's exactly what Robert Wilson was doing. And he, not only that, but then he also started creating pieces that weren't just his own, right? They were like what we would almost call nowadays a curated piece, where he would bring together specific musicians or painters or sculptors or dancers, and he would put their works together to create another work, right? And so this isn't even really the individual components aren't even his, but he's put them together in a particular way to make something new out of them. And this was, you know, the way that he approached art and theater at the time. And they were very, very massive to organize, usually very, very visually and aurally stimulating. They didn't really have any plot structure. And most of his works were performed in slow motion and highly meditative, and intended to make you focus really on the feeling and, again, the subjective experience that you yourself were getting, not necessarily some kind of universal thing, a universal message that he was trying to communicate out of his work. Also, Richard Foreman's Ontological Hysteria Theater is another theater group that obviously Richard Foreman started. And they did, you know, some of these like very mysterious performances like Rhoda and Potato Land, which was, again, more like an art exhibit than it was like a piece of theater. The stories were never linearly arranged. Sometimes, you know, you would wander from room. There was one where you wandered from room to room and some kind of unique happening was happening in each one of these rooms. Maybe it was theatrical. Maybe it was artistic and theatrical. Maybe it was musical. Maybe it was visual. And you can experience it however you choose. And again, they were meditations on art. They were meditations on characters. And very broad themes, not narratives like we're used to thinking of theater as being, right? So more of an experience and something subjective that you would walk away getting a very personal experience with. Often he sat in the front row of the theater when he was did have a more, you know, like stage production with a little, like, oh, this is a long time ago, a little boombox with a microphone. And he would talk about the ideas as the audience was watching it so that it wasn't just something you were seeing, you're actually kind of hearing the artist's thoughts on what this meant. And of course, that means that, you know, every time he's going to say something a little different because it was always impromptu. It was just his impressions and his thoughts at that particular moment, and trying to kind of give some insight into the work as well. And, you know, these often featured his very precisely arranged, he was really known for these like very precisely arranged pictures that were hung up on cords and stretched across the stage. And again, all done really to kind of deconstruct the process of thought and art and artistry. And again, this is part of that kind of postmodernism thing, is that art, there's nothing sacred about art, that there's not some kind of magical process that happens that only artists can understand, right? That part of postmodernism was kind of breaking down that wall and letting people into the process so that the process wasn't kept secret anymore, right? There was nothing secret about the process. It could be seen, and we could see the process and still not have the work itself diminished, but rather kind of get a deeper insight into the thought processes and the creative process. Also, Marabou Mines is another theater company that came out of this era. Highly visual, again. Use of pop culture imagery that they used a lot. They did a play called The Gospel at Colonus, which took a Greek drama, but then mixed it with African-American music. So they were all about mixing genres and bringing kind of two things that seemed like they should not go together and putting them together and seeing what happened. And again, that's really, you know, something that only would have been possible with, you know, first of all, the time that we were at in, you know, our development as a human species, but also in terms of postmodernism, because postmodernism broke down those rules and it said, you know, basically there are no rules. The rules are what you make. You know, so many people were able to create new things and put things together in a way that wouldn't have been possible before. Spalding Gray was also a really innovative artist at the time. He was a monologue artist. He would do, you know, he would interview people a lot of times and kind of cull narratives from the stories that he got, and then he would recreate those characters and perform these pieces representing these different characters in really high detail. He was not about dramatic action. It was not about like something exciting happening or a climactic moment. It was about just a character study. So there wasn't this kind of sense of, you know, narrative propulsion forward that we're getting to something exciting is going to happen. It was really just very, again, meditative and focusing on that you didn't need to have that to be interesting, right? You can still tell a story and it can still be interesting if the characters themselves are interesting. He often also portrays himself as a fictional character inside of his works, and a lot of his works are also very autobiographical. Now, there's another artist that came about and was highly inspired by Spalding Gray, who was a monologue artist, and she's an African-American female playwright and actress. And we're going to actually take a little look at a clip from her, one of her series. She's done a variety of things called Fires in the Mirror. And then after we're done looking at it, let's maybe have a little reflection on what we just saw. So let's watch this first from Fires in the Mirror. I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't. So good, so good. I got you. Oh, I feel nice. The sugar was fine. I feel.
James Brown raised me. I never had a father. My father left when I was 10. James Brown took me to the beauty parlor one day and made my hair like his. And made me promise to wear like that to the day I die. I always wanted a father, and he filled a void for me. And I can't think of anybody who demonstrated such strength that he reached such heights, and then he fell so low, and then he had to come back up. I can't think of anybody in life who deserved that tribute. That he wanted a kid, somebody to look like him and be just like his son. I just came back from spending a weekend with him now. I think James Brown deserved that tribute. And just like he was a father, I never had. His kids never even came to visit him when he was in jail. So I was the son he never had. And if I had to choose between arguing with people by my hairstyle or giving James Brown that one tribute he asked, I'd rather give him that tribute. And I really don't give a damn who don't understand it. Look, oh no, I know. I know, not you. But the press, everybody, do that thing on it. It's a personal family thing between me and James Brown. Just like in some communities, people have their cultural thing of who they want to look like. Ain't nothing the matter with me and James doing that. It's us. In the 50s, it was a slick. It was acting like white folks. But today, ain't nobody out here wearing their hair like that no more. Me and James are the ones doing that. So it's certainly not a reaction to whites. It's me and James's thing.
Well, different Hasidic communities have different customs about hair. And Lubavitch, the custom is, I think, that it has to be 2 inches. And some Hasidic groups have the custom of shaving the head, but that's not a Lubavitch custom. And the reason is that when you go to the mikveh bath, maybe you know, you have to be completely submerged in water, and the hair has a tendency to float, so it's much easier if the hair is shorter. And I got married when I was a little older, and I really wanted to be married, and I really wanted to, in some ways, I was eager to cover my head. Now, if I'd grown up in a Lubavitch household and then had to cut it, I don't know what that would be like, I really don't. But you know, now that I'm wearing the wig, you see, with my hair, I could keep it very simple, or I could change it all the time. I mean, with a wig, you'd have to have 5 wigs to do that. And I just feel like the wig is fake, you know, and I like to be as much myself as I possibly can, and I just feel like I'm fooling the world. When I used to work in the city, I'd wear a different wig, and people would say to me, gee, I like your new haircut. And I'd have to say, it's not mine. And it was very hard. It was very difficult to say it. And I've gone through a lot with wearing the wig and not wearing the wig. It's been a big issue for me.
Right. So that was Anna Deavere Smith. And she is a very well-known theater artist, and she's obviously a writer as well and an actress. And that was from her Fires in the Mirror, which was done years ago. And as you can see, that little section right there was about kind of hair and our relationship to our hair and our hairstyles. But what I think is really most interesting outside of that is, again, the sort of the way that she's able to take on these characters. And she's clearly not trying to like fool you that, you know, otherwise she would put on all these prosthetics to be, you know, Al Sharpton or, you know, make her face much more pale to be this Jewish woman. But she is so precise in her own way about mimicking the vocal patterns, the gestures, the sort of physicality of the people that she's, you know, reproducing for you. One of the things that I know that she does is that she records them and then she listens to what they've said over and over and over and over again, really trying to absorb every minute detail of their speech pattern, the way their voice sounds, the way they approach each word. But then you might notice that there's a little bit of an artistic quality to it as well, because when we hear her, I mean, aside from the fact that, like, you know, when she's dressed as Al Sharpton, she's clearly not a man, right? And she's not trying to make herself look like a man. She has the hairdo and the suit on, but she's not trying to look like Al Sharpton. But she sounds like him to a certain extent. But there's also this kind of like artistic license that she takes where she chooses to exaggerate certain qualities of his speech, and the same way with the other woman as well. And again, that's this sort of subjective quality that she's inputting. And another thing is that looking at both those stories, there's not really a place that the story is going, right? It's not like, you know, that Al Sharpton is telling us the time when he got chased by dogs and we're all, you know, anxiously waiting to hear what happened at the end. It's just it's a story. And it doesn't really have a good beginning or end, but it's got a theme. It's got kind of a topic. And the same thing with the other one is that we're just really listening. And what's pulling us in is not necessarily, again, that narrative pull towards tension, but it is the idea that, you know, we're watching something that is a really specific character that's intriguing in and of itself. So, again, that was Anna Deavere Smith from Fires in the Mirror. Another artist that came out of this time is Nozaki Shange, and she is a playwright that wrote a lot of very beautiful plays, and of course the one that's most well known is For Colored Girls Who Have Considered Suicide When the Rainbow Is Enough, and this is a choral poem written for seven women that perform on stage with no set and no real costumes. They're just dressed in a particular color. And that's been done lots and lots of different ways, but there's different women, you know, sometimes there's one, the red woman, the yellow woman, the blue woman. And it really is a play about honoring the beauty of black women and telling their story in a very poetic way, in a very passionate way, but certainly not a very realistic way. And I know that this was made into a film, you know, some years ago. I never watched the film, I have to admit, because it seemed so radically different from the play. But some people I know have enjoyed it. That being said, my understanding is that it is very, very different from the play. And it kind of adds a lot of things in that the play doesn't have. The play is really about seven kind of not anonymous, but almost interchangeable women that are identified just by kind of like their spirit and their movement and the type of poetry that they speak. And it's supposed to kind of tell this full story of the African-American woman in a synergistic way, right? So anyways, a very beautiful play. And one that is told, again, in a sort of unique way using poetry and mixing this form of poetry with the world of theater, and very minimal sets, like I said, and no costumes. So the focus really is on the language and on the movement, and not really on some kind of narrative story that takes place in a realistic place at a realistic time. All right, guys, well, that ends our little section here on postmodernism. We're gonna take a quick break, and then when we come back, we'll go ahead. I know some of you have written into our question of the day. We'll reiterate that when we come back, and we'll read some of your comments, as well as we'll go through our section on light and sound. So I'll see you back here in a few minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school was for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Many of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it, the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and he was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
To Theater 100, and in the second part of our broadcast today, we're going to be talking about lighting and sound. Of course, I want to remind you that even for these last 30 minutes, we are live and online. You can continue typing in your responses or calling us at 1-800-339-1193. You can type in your response at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. And of course, the question for today is, what are some objectives for a lighting designer in a play? And so a few people have typed in today. I want to make sure I get to their responses. Bailey said, some objectives for a lighting designer in a play is where the lights will move in a certain scene and how the color changes for different character effects. For instance, in a serious scene, the lights might get darker, and for a happy scene, the colors will become brighter. The angles for a light will move every which way when a performer does a tremendous scene in a play. Good, Bailey. Very nice. And Caitlin says, one objective for a lighting designer would be to use lighting to establish the time of day a scene or act is taking place. Bright, strong, and vibrant lighting could suggest mid-morning, and dim lighting could suggest dusk. Another objective for a lighting designer could be to effectively use lighting to draw attention to the main character. Yes, absolutely. We're going to be talking about those specific ones in a second. Sage says, the objective for lighting designers is to capture the moments on the stage. If you want to make the characters seem like they're in their own world or seem lonely, you have a spotlight go on them, making everything else darker. Or if you want to make it look like thunder is going on in a dramatic moment of the play, you have lights flash to the sound of the thunder. It's their job to make sure the lighting fits the theme and moments during the play and to make sure things are immersive to the audience. Yes, excellent. Good job, guys. Well, many of you have brought up some of the really salient points for what a lighting designer, what their responsibilities are, and we're certainly going to talk about those in more depth in a little bit. I want to start a little bit talking about the history of lighting design and how it evolved over time, because obviously in the beginning stages of theater, there was no such thing as a lighting designer. We didn't have electrical lights. We didn't have individual instruments on the stage. All of our theaters were outstage. And, you know, when we look to the Greek times, they would have been performed during the day. If that performance veered into the early part of the evening, which sometimes it may have, then there would have been torches brought onto the stage, and that would have been the extent of the lighting for the stage. And that continued all the way through Shakespeare's time, when we're looking at the 15th and 16th century, the 14th and the 15th centuries, that lighting on the stage was still done, primarily it was lit by the sun, sunlight. Shows were done during the day, during the late part of the afternoon, and if the sun, you know, sometimes shows would kind of go into that early dusk period, and then torches would be lit so that the actors could be seen. But that really was the extent of the lighting. There's no need to have a lighting designer when you've got the sun and you've got, you know, your torches. It wasn't until the end of the Elizabethan age, when we get to the end of the 15th century, moving on into the 16th century, that we get theaters moving indoors. And part of the way that was done was with candles, and candles that had reflectors behind them, and obviously a massive amount of candles and chandeliers that had candles set onto them. And this was intended to be able to light up the entire space. And these instances, of course, it wasn't just the stage that was lit, it was the house where the audience sits as well, because there certainly wouldn't have been enough light on stage just from the candle illumination to allow for there to be enough light into the house for people to see where they were going and not hurt themselves if they were trying to get up and move around. And certainly that was part of the experience at the time. So, you know, there were these candles. You might imagine this was maybe not the best idea when you have people in these elaborate costumes with women in very long skirts and kind of frilly elements all over. And obviously there's no such thing as flame retardant material. So it was not uncommon, not only even before this time, for theaters to burn down, but it was not uncommon for actors or actresses especially to move downstage into the footlights and to have their costumes catch on fire and then either, you know, harm the actor or burn down the theater. Costumes also often had glittering elements, kind of like reflective elements on them to kind of, you know, enhance the sense of light on the stage. But you can imagine that this was still very, very ineffective, an ineffective way of lighting actors and scenery on a stage. So it's not really until we get gas and gas-powered illumination on the stage that we really start to enter into the modern era of lighting design in 1803. And so what basically happened is that we switched. Gas illumination came about in the 19th century, 1800s. And what they would do is they would run natural gas through these, you know, copper pipes. And they would put little holes in the pipe. And then you would, just like you would on your stove or you would, you know, with anything else that has natural gas coming out of it, you put a flame to that and it ignites the gas and then you've got a constant flame. You know, one of the nice things about moving from candles to gas illumination was that aside from the fact that it was not a very effective way to light the stage, it was and dangerous, it was also really, really smoky. And nowadays we have candles that are very what they call clean burning candles, right? And this is because they're made from beeswax or they're made from very clean wax that was, you know, has been cleaned in such a way that there aren't any things in there that are going to catch fire and create a lot of smoke, as well as that the filament that we use, that we burn to burn down to create the illumination, is a very clean burning filament. But this is not what was around at the time that they started using candles and as it was used for hundreds of years. These were very dirty burning candles. Oftentimes they were made from lard or animal fats that were not strained and cleaned very well. And those burn very dirty. What does that mean? It means that it creates a lot of smoke and in sometimes even ash. The filament itself was not clean burning. And so you can imagine if you had a whole chandelier of these candles that would be relit many times. They'd have to change the candles out and relight them many times. That after several hours of being in an enclosed space with all of these things, that it would be quite smoky and kind of, you know, not very good air to breathe inside of this enclosed space. So there was not only that problem, but the ash itself would stain the walls of the theater. And if you were a frequent theater goer or you were an actor that was on the stage, your clothing would become stained by the ash. And there were so many not good things about using candles in these closed door environments. So when we changed to gas, one of the big things that really improved was the air quality inside of the theater. There wasn't this haze that was covering the theater the entire time. It was also very clean burning. There was no ash, there was no smoke. But we still had an open flame setting on the stage that obviously could cause problems should it get near a piece of fabric and light, you know, the actor or a prop or the wooden floor on fire, right? So that was obviously not also the best solution. Fortunately, not too long afterwards, as we move into the 1880s and the turn of the century, the Industrial Revolution, you know, starts up, and larger theaters are beginning to evolve. There's a middle-class audience that's pouring in. There's a lot of money pouring into these theaters, and they are bolstered by the innovations that are happening in the mechanical electrical world. And the incandescent light gets invented, right? And so once the incandescent light bulb gets invented, you know, the theaters begin, and they have the resources, they begin to remove all their gas lighting and switch over to incandescent lighting. And this really solidified the McCandless approach to lighting. And McCandless was the guy who basically wrote the book on lighting using incandescent lighting. And it was established by the 1930s, and it was a way to light the stage. It was a way to use the stage, and a concept of how to use, as some of you were saying, different colors to indicate different times of day, where to place lighting, what types of ways to section off lighting, and all the stuff that was invented during that time, right? And this was basically used until the 90s, when we moved over to a completely electrical system and using more high-powered incandescent lights that were controlled by, you know, what we call dimmers, which are sliders on a board that were connected to a big series of circuits that were hidden on the stage somewhere. And then we could control the lights that way as well. Up until that point, guys, and this really wasn't that long ago, because I always tell the story, I went to a theater, and I went to a high school where we had a theater that had the old 1950 dimmers. And the 1950s dimmers did not have what we have now. Now we have this nice little compact thing that's maybe here, I'm gonna bring this out just as an example, maybe as big as this keyboard. Where a little bit thicker, where we just have levers and we have buttons, it's all digitized, and we have a computer screen, and we can operate everything off of this very small unit. And it has memory and all this stuff. But even, you know, after that, in the like 80s and 90s, we had already moved over to maybe not fully programmable, but semi-programmable dimmer boards that were pretty, you know, sophisticated, but obviously I was in high school, we didn't have a ton of money. Our theater still had these giant dimmer switches. And basically, if you can imagine, there was a room, and like all theaters in the 40s, 50s, in the 60s had these. And it was basically a room. There would be two rooms, one usually off left and one off right. I think we only had one room because we didn't have that many dimmers. And there would be a small room like the size of a closet. And all along the walls of the room would be these giant levers. And the levers are maybe anywhere from 3 to 4 foot in height, maybe like a foot in width. And there are these giant, you know, levers all across the wall. So maybe there's 10 on top and then 10 on the bottom. And if you want to reach the top ones and you're short like me, you're going to have a ladder to go up there and pull that lever. And then they line all the walls. And maybe you have 20 or 30 in this room. And each one of those levers is connected to an instrument, which is a light. That's what we call light in the world of theater. An instrument on the stage. Okay, that is lighting a specific area on a stage. And the levers are there to either bring the light up, dim the light up, or dim the light down, right? And so I didn't do a lot of technical stuff in theater, it was mostly on the stage, but I do remember one time I helped out with a technical thing in that room. And we, as the tech crew, we had like all the lines, we could hear that this closet room was open to the stage. So you could hear the actors on the stage pretty well. But you would have your script with you, and you would have written down next to certain things which levers needed to go up and how quickly and where they were. And this is literally this like manpower job where we're like running around, okay, I'm going to take down these two and you're going to take down those two at the same time. And then we're going to take down, you know, so there was a master that would take everything out if we needed to do a blackout. But it was just really so primitive. And I went to school I was in high school in the early 90s. So, you know, it was just very, very bizarre. I remember seeing for the first time an actual like dimmer pack and being like so amazed that you didn't have to pull these giant levers on the wall. But it wasn't until, you know, the 80s or 90s that we really had these compact dimmer packs that were operating all the lights. And the other benefit of that meant that one person could operate all the lights on the stage. And secondly, that you didn't have to be on the stage, right? You could be sitting in the back of the house and you could be watching the show, seeing that you're doing the correct thing, right? And making sure the lights actually look right. We certainly couldn't do that. We did have headsets. We were talking to the stage manager the whole time, making sure that we were doing the right thing. But we certainly could not see really what was happening on the stage. We were so busy, you know, running around and pulling all these levers. So we are going to now go ahead and hit some of these objectives. I know some of you have written in here to hit some of them. I'm sure some of you are talking about them here. But what are some of the objectives? I'm going to read through them and then we'll hit each one of them. Well, some of the objectives, of course, is to provide visibility, right? Visibility and mood. If the audience can't see the actors, then we have a problem. They can't see the expressions on the actors' faces, where they're walking to, who they're speaking to. This is really important. Mood is also important, too. The colors establish a kind of feeling. We say for comedy, we want bright colors that are usually warm in spectrum. And for, you know, dramas, we usually want darker stages with things that are cooler in the spectrum. So it definitely establishes mood and tone for the piece, and also visibility. To reveal shapes and forms, right? We need to be able to see things. Sometimes we need to see one thing at one moment, and then that thing needs to disappear, and we need to see something else, right? And light helps to direct the audience's eye to certain things, and also to visually create certain things on the stage that maybe we wouldn't be able to create otherwise. It also provides depth and a three-dimensionality to the stage. Focus and composition. Again, the audience needs to know where to look. Should I be looking at this person over here? Wait a second, is that part of the stage? Am I supposed to be looking at that part of the stage? You know, I just did, like, as you all know, She Kills Monsters, and that was a very amorphous set, right? It was what we call like a unit set. We were in the same place. The set didn't change. Even though we moved around to different locations, the set was very flexible. It did, you know, could be all different kinds of things. Sometimes we were in this D&D world, sometimes we were in a high school, college counselor's office. So it just depended on where we were. And a lot of that story was told through light. It was told through, the audience was getting, you know, where are we by the type of lights that are on, by where the light is shining on the stage. Oh, that part of the stage is dark. Now we're supposed to look over here. So it helps to create that focus and to enhance sometimes composition, the way that a scene is set up visually, the way that the important points of focus are set up in that scene. Creating mood and style, right? Is this a fantasy play, like, you know, like She Kills Monsters were, where we could have all these interesting, crazy lights and doing all kinds of things? Or is this a very realistic play in which we're simply trying to duplicate the real kind of color of the world? It's supposed to be afternoon, you know, it should look like an afternoon. You know, it's supposed to be inside of an office, it should look like the inside of an office, right? So it depends, and the lights set that for us. If we see that the lights are very, you know, dramatic and theatrical, then we know that we're really not in a very realistic setting. Whereas if we see lights that are really just there to create, you know, establish a time of day and a location, then again, we know that this is a more realistic style of play. Establish time and place, right? We need to know what time of day it is a lot of times. Is it nighttime? Then we want to throw a ton of blue light on the stage. Is it morning? Maybe we have a brighter sense. We can use a scrim in the back, which is a piece of fabric that we can project onto and throw lights onto to create all kinds of effects. We can make it look like a cloudy day. We can make it look like sunset, right? We can do all kinds of things back there to help the audience to understand the time of day, as well as the place. You know, the way that lighting looks inside, like inside of a studio like this, is very different from the way something looks if we're supposed to be out on a beach somewhere, right, on the shore. So those things as well, establishing for the audience what the time is, the season, and the place. And establishing a rhythm. Rhythm is so important with lights. I mean, this is honestly something as a director that I learned more and more the longer that I've been directing, is that part of the rhythm of the piece is established with how we use the lights and how we use them to create transitions between scenes. Because as a director, you know, you have a choice. Do I need to go to a full blackout here? Is that what I'm, you know, need? And that's a real, when we think about a blackout, that's a real plot pause for the audience. It's a break, right? Nothing is happening on stage now. And maybe that's required. Or do I want to go to some kind of transitional lighting here where we continue the sense of flow from one scene into the next, even if that means that we see actors moving across the stage? You know, do I have actors walking into the light so that no scene is ever really ending, where there's just kind of one ending as one begins? Or do I have a light change here that really creates a sense that a different moment is happening? And that takes time as well. So timing and pacing is really so dependent, not obviously only on what the actors are doing, the way the play is written, but they're established through lighting and the rhythms that are created through the types of cues that we call. And you can slow a play down or you can speed a play up depending on that rhythm and the way those lighting cues are called. And also to reinforce a central image. With this one, I'm really reminded of the last play that was just done here, which was The Promise in our smaller space. And lighting there can always be really difficult, and it's not because we're just limited in the number of instruments that we have available to us in that space, but because the space is so small and the stage is so small that you get something that we call in the theater, we call bleed, right? And that means that it can be very hard to do very isolated lighting in that room because there's just really only so tight, you know, light has a life of its own too, and physics are physics, and there's just only so tight that you can get a light in that room and still be doing all the objectives of illuminating our actors, illuminating, you know, the space, creating mood and all that while still, you know, telling a story or highlighting a particular image. And one of the things that was highlighted a few times in that piece was the altar and these kind of religious images that were kind of focused on over and over again. And there were these places on the stage where these elements were, I remember looking at some of them before the play began, but then when the lights would come onto that area, you know, you can't help but look at whatever is, you know, in this bright light. And suddenly that image like gains so much more importance to you. And it takes on a whole different kind of meaning and weight. And when you see those images kind of repeated over and over again, and highlighted over and over again, then the sort of theme of the piece becomes maybe hopefully more apparent to you as an audience member. And I know that certainly happened in The Promise, thanks to the wonderful direction of Shoni Holmes and our lighting designer that we work with all the time, Fred DuPonte. Also, I directed a show a year ago called Mach and All, and there's a really important visual element in that show. I don't want to get into too much detail, but basically it's a flower, it's a water lily in a ceramic container. And it doesn't come in until like halfway through the play, but it becomes like this really important symbol for this love and newfound energy that the character has found and that eventually dies, right? And so there's a lot of symbolism that is kind of thrust upon this very, very simple object. And it was really important to me and the lighting designer that the symbolism of that object become very apparent to the audience and that it not just be a flower in a pot, right? And so when the flower first appears, you know, we made sure that even before anyone in the play mentions it, that it's had its own special light. And it was like as far downstage as we could possibly get it. And then, of course, in these other interactions, we made sure to highlight it again. I remember at the end of the first scene where we see it even, that it was not only like one of the things that was highlighted the most at the top of the scene, but that at the end it was one of the last things that we took out, right? We took out all the other lights and then we took out that light. So we had this final image of actually the main lead actress holding the potted plant in her arms. And of course, I mean, this thing just becomes so immensely important throughout the course of the entire play. It was really important that visual or central image become really associated with something more than just a plant in a pot. So we can see that, you know, there are so many things that lighting designers are doing and helping to create and setting up. It's really one of the most important elements in a show, just depending on the show that you're doing. And some of the things that a lighting designer is thinking about as he's working through these objectives is also the properties that he has to work with. So what are the properties of light? And how does the lighting designer use those properties to achieve the objectives and tell the story effectively? Well, one of the The properties of light is, of course, intensity. And that just simply means how bright a light is, right? We can have a light be very, very hot, as we call it, or we can have it be very, very dim, cool, right? And that's usually the way that we talk about it when we're creating stuff for the stage. I might say, like, you know, oh, that area upstage right is way too hot. Can we bring it down? Because anywhere where there's a really, really hot spot on stage, that's where the audience's eye is going to go to. So we want to make sure that we're only doing that when we really want the audience's attention in a particular place. For instance, when I was talking about that plant being lit up, very hot. We lit it up so it looked like it was glowing almost, right? But that was important to that moment. Now, if it had just been a comb or something on the stage that didn't have any purpose, that would be very strange. But it was a really important image to have lit. Also, color. What colors are we using? You know, there was a time, in fact, in recent, when I first started directing and when I was, you know, an actor in high school and college and grad school, where the only way to change the color of a light was to put a piece of very thin plastic in front of it called a gel. And this gel would be colored, and they came in bazillions of colors, right? And you'd order these giant sheets called gel sheets, and then you, as the student or the intern or whatever, would end up sitting there cutting out all of the sheets to fit into the barn door frames, the gel frames, that would slide into the front of the instrument so that when the light shone through, because all instrument light was white, but when it shone through the gel, then you would color that light. But what you might imagine, which is true, some of the drawbacks to this type of lighting is that you only get that lamp can only ever be one color, right? You can't suddenly like bring all the electrics out in the middle of your show and go, oh, well, then now I need this light to be green instead of blue. So hurry, let's change the gel frame out. So once you set the lighting plot, which is where all the instruments are on the electrics and what part of the stage those instruments are lighting and what gel colors are in those instruments, that's what it is, right? For the run of the show, you can't go, you know, just suddenly changing things. So it's a very static system and in a way, a lot of ways, a very inefficient system. And so many things have changed in the last 15 to 20 years. And one of the things that I think I appreciate the most is that we have now moved into the era of pure LED lighting and smart lighting. So what does that mean? Well, what that means now is that instead of having a big, ginormous instrument that was usually, I mean, this is probably small. This is maybe more the size of our smaller, like, ellipsoidal instruments that we have. The Fresnels are probably like this, right? Very big, very heavy, run very hot, only one color, only can be in one direction because you bolt that thing down and it's pointing one way. Now we have these very light, they're about this big and about that thick, LED lights. They have the capacity to be any color that you want, so they're full spectrum. I can change that one lamp, I can have it be green in one scene, I can have it be blue in another scene, I can have it be goldenrod in another scene. And it can also move all around. So we have the capacity to have it do all kinds of different things that we didn't have it before. And that brings us, of course, to direction as well. Where the lamp is shining. Is it over here? Is it over there? Is it, you know, going to shine on somebody's face or somewhere else? And last but not least, movement. Do the lights move? Are they physically moving? Or do we have a sense of movement through the lights? And that's through the way that we call the cues. And also the direction of the lamp. Now we can have lamps move all over. So, okay, we just barely covered everything. We really didn't get to some of the things we might have to cover that next time. We had a lot to cover today, but we got through the main points. Guys, don't forget that you need to turn in your stage review by Sunday. And also don't forget that you've got a couple tests that are coming up as well. Next week we'll be talking about Angels in America. I look forward to it. Thank you for tuning in. And I hope you have a great week, and I will see you next week.